Hello and welcome to the TINR Oral History Project. My name is Paul Warhit, and I welcome Damon Marr to be interviewed for this program. The date is July 29th, 2019, and we are both participating in the recording of this archive at the Edith Handelman Library in Temple, Israel. The interviewee, Damon Marr, has agreed to and signed the interviewer and interviewee release dated March 1, 2019. With the formalities completed, let's begin the interview. Damon, how old are you and where were you born?
63 and a half years old this month. Born at St. Joseph's Hospital in Yonkers, New York.
Nice. How would you describe yourself as a child?
Very happy child. Firstborn, so I got all the attention, much more than the others, I thought, and I was a very obedient Catholic school student.
And how many siblings do you have?
Four younger siblings, brother and three sisters.
It's a total of five.
Total of five.
Nice. Yeah. I did the math there.
Well, small Catholic family.
What is your best memory of childhood?
Oh, just we played baseball all the time. You know, especially in the summer, we'd leave the house and come back around lunchtime, have a quick peanut butter and jelly sandwich, head right back down to the field. No parents, no coaches. We chose up teams ourselves, and they were always very fair. And, you know, just a great time doing that, or even just... usually, when it's not summer, we play more ball in people's backyards. There was still some empty lots around where we lived. You know, a lot of mothers were not working, were full-time moms and homemakers. So they were around as well, but they weren't worried about us until, you know, lunchtime, and then you go out again and come back 5 o'clock.
Now, you seem to be focused on the peanut butter and jelly question. When you make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, do you put the jelly on the opposite bread, or do you put it on top of the peanut butter?
I think I put it on the opposite.
Good.
Of course, in those days, I had a mom who, you know, did everything for me.
Fair enough.
In fact, you know, when I moved from my mom's house to my wife's home without any transition in between, you know, my wife has said I've had 63 years of supported living, right?
Assisted
living. See, I need to assist with that too.
So, as far as childhood memories, you shared some wonderful memories. How about a not so great? What was your worst childhood memory?
That's a tough one. Maybe a couple of times because I was such a perfect kid. There were a couple of times when I got disciplined by the nuns in Catholic school I went to. It was pretty traumatic. I mean, they could be really serious about humiliating you in front of your classmates, or you know, sending you home with a note to your parents saying, you know, let him explain to you what he did. And that was pretty.
That
tough.
Was always a bad note to come
that
home.
That was tough. But it didn't happen as often for me as for my brother, for example.
What did you think your life would be like when you were older?
When I was a child, what did I think? You know, I don't think I really thought much about it. I know, you know, of many, like a game I played in my own room is I had a desk and I would set it up like, you know, what I thought a person working in an office would look like, you know, with my pens here and my blotter here. Didn't think about a computer, you know, being there, or even that I would ever have to type in my whole life.
And you said blotter or bladder?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Yes.
In school, what kind of a student were you?
As a kid, very, very good student. Again, you know, talking about Catholic school, there are certain behavioral traits that they kind of like and require, and I was very good at that, sitting at my desk, and the kinds of schoolwork we did, you know, very basic reading and writing and arithmetic stuff, and you know, so, Yeah, I was the, you know, I got the General Excellence Award every year.
Okay.
Through high school.
I'd like to ask you some questions about family history.
Sure.
What country did your mother's ancestors come from?
Many, on my mother's side. The ones I like to talk about most because I know them. My great-grandfather lived until I was a teenager, so I knew him pretty well. He was from the hill country outside of Naples.
This is your
great-grandfather.
Your mother's grandfather.
Mother's grandfather.
Wow. Okay.
And I've done some genealogical research on his part of the family. Also, there are some Germans who came over in the 1840s, and some Scots-Irish in that side of the family who've been around a long time. They were from upstate New York. I'm not quite sure when they came over. So a little bit of a mix of every, and again, all Catholic on that side, German Catholics, etc. And yeah, that pretty much covers that.
And your father's family?
Fathers, they were all Irish immigrants. Let's see, it was one, my great-grandfather was one of them, and I didn't meet him. He died a little bit before I was born. Very small, but there were people from my family for about 100 years in Hastings.
And your parents were both born in the States?
Yes.
And how did they meet?
They met at a wedding reception. I think my father was with a bunch of guys who crashed the party or something, and apparently it's a good way to meet. They're a little annoying. I'm going to put this one over here and hopefully it doesn't make any more noise.
And was it love at first sight for them?
I don't know about that. I think they're both probably at that age where they were thinking, you know, they wanted to settle down with somebody.
How old were they?
Oh, like, let's see, like 23 and 21, which I guess is, you know, that's a little young by today's standards.
And yeah, and how did they? How long did they date before they decided to get married?
I don't think it was very long, maybe a little over a year. I'm not quite sure.
It's more than 9 months, though. Are your parents still alive?
No, both
deceased. Did your mother or father have a good sense of humor?
They had different senses of humor. Both good in their own right. My mother knew one joke, I think, and which she would repeat. And my dad was a big people person, and he actually put on a great performance here three times. We had three B'nai Mitzvah here, and he got up and sang an Irish tune each time.
Did your parents both work?
My mother mostly did not work. She didn't work when we were kids. I think as soon as kids came along, she was at home the whole time, and then she went back to work much later after everybody was out.
And what did she do?
So the last job she was doing, she's doing medical transcription. You know, again, this is 100 years from now. Doctors would talk into a little machine and make a tape. Hmm. And somebody had to transcribe that into a written record. So she was working over at St. Vincent's Hospital in Harrison.
And what about your father?
Father worked in banking his entire career. You know, in the olden days, banks used to be, especially in Westchester County, a bank used to be a building. That was a bank, mm-hmm. one bank. And then, so he was with one of those, and eventually they all started merging into each other, and there was something called the National Bank of Westchester, where he worked, and that was eventually, after several more mergers, that was merged into Chase Manhattan, Chase Bank. And so when he retired, that was the bank he was with. He was generally the manager of branches all over the county. So he did an assignment for a few years. Spent most of the time in Harrison, but as I say, a lot of other communities around the area, so we always knew somebody whenever we, you know, go out shopping or whatever, people would stop in.
Give us a sense of what family meals were like growing up.
You know, say seven people around the table, you had to be fast. Now, you can see how thin I am. I wasn't as fast. No, it was basic, meat and potatoes type family.
Who did the cooking?
Oh, Mom, of course. Apparently they had invented fresh fruit and vegetables by then. You know, stuff came, I mean, you know, God bless her, but that's, you know, it's suburban folks in those days. It wasn't a thing to go out so much and get fresh fruits and vegetables, but you know, so we were a meat and potatoes kind of family, and there could be raucous discussions around the table, because even as I was younger, I was already kind of a different political philosophy from my dad. So it could be interesting discussions.
And was your mom a good cook?
Yeah, good basic okay. stuff, yeah.
What do you remember most about your mother and your father?
Oh boy, so much. I mean, my mom was especially very proud of us, but very protective. You know, loyalty to the greatest extent. Of course, anybody you know said anything about us, and we'd have made some neighborhood disputes, and she'd step in on our behalf because we could. Do no wrong, at least as far as other people are concerned. Inside the house, you know, maybe we did.
Who was the disciplinarian?
Really, Mom. You know, you know, you get some of this. Wait till your father comes home. But he was kind of a softy. Very, you know, and more about him. More of a gregarious guy. You know, he'd stop and talk with anybody, which would frustrate my mother. When you're trying to get something done. I have found, you know, since he passed away, just a little bit before I got into the whole political gig, I've taken on some of his characteristics at this point, such as not being able to stop talking, like right now.
Let's see. So you said you were brought up a good Catholic boy.
I was the chief altar boy.
You tell us about your religious beliefs growing up?
Oh, I was a very true, sincere believer. Mm-hmm. You and I might have discussed this when we had the course a couple of years ago. I looked at a God who was kind of like an accountant at an accounting book, you know, looking down, oh, there's a credit, there's a debit, and I wanted to build up a lot of credits, you know. Somebody's watching you. Not like today, when somebody is watching you everywhere with a camera. But you know, I kind of grew up with that idea that there is somebody watching what you do and do good. You know, my siblings always would tease me and say, yeah, "Why do you have to? It's so much easier to do good and not get in trouble." You know, the way they might have been.
And do you still adhere to that philosophy?
Well, my view of God is different. I know there's something that's greater than you and me. Certainly you.
Yeah, our wives.
Certainly you. our wives, I like that. Well, they're goddesses in and of themselves. We worship them.
Yes, we do.
But, you know, it's interesting talking again about the class that you and I attended, and you facilitated some of them right across the hall here.
They
were in this room.
The God question.
Yeah, in this room. You know, at that point, I had been somewhat alienated. I hadn't been going to church that often or at all over a long period of time. And that was one of the things that helped me connect back. I mean, it's been much since that time. I've spent more time in the Catholic Church. And as a politician, I spend more time in every church, you know, and synagogue and everything. But, you know, that was one of the things that kind of brought me back. In a different way. I'm not the altar boy, and I don't picture, you know, a man with a beard, you know, making it. Might be a woman up there who's doing, right? Who's doing the double entry accounting. But you know, it's part of who I am. You know, I'm here a lot, with my wife, who's Jewish, right?
Hello and welcome to the TINR Oral History Project. My name is Paul Warhit, and I welcome Damon Marr to be interviewed for this program. The date is July 29th, 2019, and we are both participating in the recording of this archive at the Edith Handelman Library in Temple Israel. The interviewee, Damon Marr, has agreed to and signed the interviewer and interviewee release dated March 1, 2019. With the formalities completed, let's begin the interview. Damon, how old are you and where were you born?
63 and a half years old this month. Born at St. Joseph's Hospital in Yonkers, New York.
Nice. How would you describe yourself as a child?
Very happy child. First born, so I got all the attention, much more than the others, I thought, and I was a very obedient Catholic school student.
And how many siblings do you have?
Four younger siblings, brother and three sisters.
It's a total of five.
Total of five.
Nice.
Yeah.
I did the math there.
Well, small Catholic family.
What is your best memory of childhood?
Oh, just we played baseball all the time. Especially in the summer, we'd leave the house and come back around lunchtime, have a quick peanut butter jelly sandwich, head right back down to the field. No parents, no coaches. We chose up teams ourselves, and they were always very fair. And great time doing that, or even just usually when it's not summer, we play more ball in people's backyards. There was still some empty lots around where we lived, a lot of mothers were not working, were full-time moms and homemakers, so they were around as well, but they weren't worried about us until, lunchtime, and then you go out again and come back 5 o'clock.
Now, you seem to be focused on the peanut butter and jelly question. When you make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, do you put the jelly on the opposite bread, or do you put it on top of the peanut butter?
I think I put it on the opposite.
Good.
Of course, in those days, I had a mom who, did everything for me.
Fair enough.
In fact, when I moved from my mom's house to my wife's home without any transition in between, my wife has said I've had 63 years of supported living,
right?
Assisted living. See, I need to assist with that too.
So, as far as childhood memories, you shared some wonderful memories. How about a not so great? What was your worst childhood memory?
That's a tough one. Maybe a couple of times because I was such a perfect kid. A couple of times when I got disciplined by the nuns in Catholic school I went to. It was pretty traumatic. I mean, they could be really serious about humiliating you in front of your classmates, or sending you home with a note to your parents saying, let him explain to you what he did. And that was pretty.
That
tough.
Was always a bad.
That
note
was
to come.
That
home.
Was tough. But it didn't happen as often for me as for my brother, for example.
What did you think your life would be like when you were older?
When I was a child, what did I think? I don't think I really thought much about it. I know, of many, a game I played in my own room is I had a desk and I would set it up like, what I thought a person working in an office would look like, with my pens here and my blotter here. Didn't think about a computer, being there, or even that I would ever have to type in my whole life.
And you said blotter or bladder?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Yes.
In school, what kind of a student were you?
As a kid, very, very good student. Talking about Catholic school, certain behavioral traits that they kind of like and require, and I was very good at that, sitting at my desk, and the kinds of schoolwork we did, very basic reading and writing and arithmetic stuff, and I was the, you know, I got the General Excellence Award every year.
Okay.
Through high school.
I'd like to ask you some questions about family history.
Sure.
What country did your mother's ancestors come from?
Many, on my mother's side. The ones I like to talk about most because I know them. My great-grandfather lived until I was a teenager, so I knew him pretty well. He was from the hill country outside of Naples.
This is your great-grandfather?
Great-grandfather.
Your mother's grandfather?
Mother's grandfather.
Wow. Okay.
And I've done some genealogical research on his part of the family. Also, there are some Germans who came over in the 1840s, and some Scots-Irish in that side of the family who've been around a long time. They were from upstate New York. I'm not quite sure when they came over. So a little bit of mix of every, and again, all Catholic on that side, German Catholics, etc. And that pretty much covers that.
And your father's family?
Father's, they were all Irish immigrants. It was one, my great-grandfather was one of them, and I didn't meet him. He died a little bit before I was born. Very small, but there were people from my family for about 100 years in Hastings.
And your parents were both born in the States?
Yes.
And how did they meet?
They met at a wedding reception. I think my father was with a bunch of guys who crashed the party or something, and apparently it's a good way to meet. They're a little annoying. We're going to put this one over here and hopefully it doesn't make any more noise.
And was it love at first sight for them?
I don't know about that. I think they're both probably at that age where they were thinking, they wanted to settle down with somebody.
How old were they?
Oh, like 23 and 21, which I guess is, that's a little young by today's standards.
And how did they? How long did they date before they decided to get married?
I don't think it was very long. Maybe a little over a year. I'm not quite sure.
It's more than 9 months, though. Are your parents still alive?
No, both
deceased. Did your mother or father have a good sense of humor?
They had different senses of humor. Both good in their own right. My mother knew one joke, I think, and which she would repeat. And my dad was a big people person, and he actually put on a great performance here three times. We had three B'nai Mitzvah here, and he got up and sang an Irish tune each time.
Did your parents both work?
My mother mostly did not work. She didn't work when we were kids. I think as soon as kids came along, she was at home the whole time, and then she went back to work much later after everybody was out.
And what did you do?
So the last job she was doing, she's doing medical transcription. Again, this is 100 years from now. Doctors would talk into a little machine and make a tape. Hmm. And somebody had to transcribe that into a written record. So she was working over at St. Vincent's Hospital in Harrison.
And what about your father?
Father worked in banking his entire career. In the olden days, banks used to be, especially in Westchester County, a bank used to be a building. That was a bank, one bank. And then, so he was with one of those, and eventually they all started merging into each other, and there was something called the National Bank of Westchester, where he worked, and that was eventually, after several more mergers, that was merged into Chase Manhattan, Chase Bank. And so when he retired, that was the bank he was with. He was generally the manager of branches all over the county. So he'd get an assignment for a few years. Spent most of the time in Harrison, but as I say, a lot of other communities around the area, so we always knew somebody whenever we, you know, go out shopping or whatever, people would stop in.
Give us a sense of what family meals were like growing up.
You know, say seven people around the table, you had to be fast. You can see how thin I am. I wasn't as fast. No, it was basic. Meat and potatoes type family.
Who did the cooking?
Oh, mom, of course.
Right. And was
apparently
she,
they
was
had
she a
invented
good cook?
Fresh fruit and vegetables by then. You know, stuff came, I mean, you know, God bless her, but that's, you know, it's suburban folks in those days. It wasn't a thing to go out so much and get fresh fruits and vegetables, but you know, so we were a meat and potatoes kind of family, and there could be raucous discussions around the table, because even as I was younger, I was already kind of a different political philosophy from my dad. So it could be interesting discussions.
And was your mom a good cook?
Yeah, good basic okay. stuff, yeah.
What do you remember most about your mother and your father?
Oh boy, so much. I mean, my mom was especially very proud of us, but very protective. You know, loyalty to the greatest extent. Of course, anybody you know said anything about us, and we'd have made some neighborhood disputes, and she'd step in on our behalf, and of course we could do no wrong, at least as far as other people are concerned. Inside the house, you know, maybe we did.
Who was the disciplinarian?
Really, mom. You know, you get some of this, wait till your father comes home, but he was kind of a softy. Very, you know, and more about him, more of a gregarious guy. He'd stop and talk with anybody, which would frustrate my mother no end when you're trying to get something done. I have found, you know, since he passed away, just a little bit before I got into the whole political gig, I've taken on some of his characteristics at this point, such as not being able to stop talking, like right now.
Let's see. So you said you were brought up a good Catholic boy.
I was the chief altar boy.
So can you tell us about your religious beliefs growing up?
Oh, I was a very true, sincere believer.
Mm-hmm.
You and I might have discussed this when we had the course a couple of years ago. I sort of kind of looked at a God who was kind of like an accountant at an accounting book, you know, looking down, oh, there's a credit, there's a debit, and I wanted to build up a lot of credits, you know. Somebody's watching you. Not like today, when somebody is watching you everywhere with the camera. But, you know, I kind of grew up with that idea that there is somebody watching what you do, and do good, you know. My siblings always would tease me and say, why do you have to? It's so much easier to do good and not get in trouble, you know, the way they might have been.
And do you still adhere to that philosophy?
Well, my view of God is different. I know there's something that's greater than you and me. Certainly you.
Yeah, our wives.
Certainly you. Our wives, I like that. Well, they're goddesses in and of themselves. We worship them.
Yes, we do.
But, you know, it's interesting talking again about the class that you and I attended, and you facilitated some of them right across the hall here.
It was in this room.
They were in this room.
The God question.
Yeah, in this room. At that point, I had been somewhat alienated. I hadn't been going to church that often or at all over a long period of time. And that was one of the things that helped me connect back. I mean, it had been much since that time. I've spent more time in the Catholic Church. And as a politician, I spend more time in every church, you know, and synagogue and everything. But, that was one of the things that kind of brought me back. In a different way. I'm not the altar boy, and I don't picture, you know, a man with a beard, you know, making it. It might be a woman up there who's doing, right? Who's doing the double entry accounting. But you know, it's part of who I am. You know, I'm here a lot, with my wife, who's Jewish, right?
Okay, tell us about your wife, Deborah.
Deborah Levy Moore. She's terrific. Met her in December 1979. First date January 1980, and engaged by May of that year, married by January of the next year. We met at a party, and let's see, it was, this will get confusing. Okay, so we were all out of college for a couple of years. She had a friend from high school who had an apartment in 23rd Street, 2nd Avenue, and a roommate. Those two young ladies were dating two friends of mine from college, and I got invited to this party. They actually lived in the same building as well as these two young ladies, and so I was invited to this party, and you know, they had thought of many guys to fix Deborah up with, never thought of me, but I met her at this party, and yeah, it was, I thought she was pretty cool. And, you know, so her friend, you know, I told her friend, and her friend said, Damon's going to call you. And she said, Damon who? But it went better from there. And so anyway, these three couples are all still married. The three, you know, this is quite a thing. We just saw each other a couple of weeks ago. We see each other several times a year. It's a bunch of friends who are all living in the New York area. Still together, still the same. First wife, first husband thing.
Mm-hmm. Where did you live when you were first married?
At Deborah's apartment in 101 West 12th Street, West Village in Manhattan.
And you both worked?
Yes, Deborah was working for whatever the bank was called then. She was also in a bank that went through several transformations and ended up being Chase Manhattan. I think it was called Chemical Bank, where she was working in a branch, and I was working at that insurance defense and construction law firm in Midtown. We were both in Midtown. We were just a couple blocks away from each other at the time.
And then you started working for her father's law firm.
Correct.
And where was that?
That was then. That was at 57th and Broadway.
And you worked with Deborah's father?
Yeah.
And how long did you work together?
Until he retired. Mid-90s, at least 15 years. Yeah.
How did that work out?
Very well. You know, called him by first name. He'd never, you know, he when I first met him, he was very easy to get along with. He was, you know, Deborah's parents seemed much closer to our age, just by temperament and attitudes and that sort of thing. So we called him, you know, I called him by first name. Deborah called my parents, mom and dad. And the age difference was maybe 2 or 3 years, tops. But just a different kind of relationship. And she took such good care of my father when my father was ill. You know, it's just amazing. And she, you know, just because most of my siblings are away, far away. And, you know, so one of my sisters who's around, and Deborah really bore the brunt of some pretty difficult times with him when he was sick. And in not just a few months, the last few years before he passed away. Yeah, just good to marry a person of good character.
Always highly recommended.
And has a good sense of humor, smart, lovely. You know, good stuff.
And you said you were on 12th Street. How long were you there, and where did you move from?
Let's
there?
See, for about two to three years, moved to Larchmont, a small house, you know, walking distance to the train station, which was a prime selling point that we could walk to the train. Because we didn't not be wed to a car at that point. You know, when we first moved up, we didn't have a car for a while. It was that close to the train station.
And what about kids? When did they come along and where
they
did you
come
go from
along
there?
Right away. Mm-hmm. You know, let's see. I guess we were in Larchmont. Well, it's more complicated than that. Because before we had biological children, we signed up as foster parents with Westchester County. So we had a foster baby with us in 1 year. Who went had a couple of stints with us up and down, you know, because the theory then and still is very much so try to reunite the child with biological family. And it was difficult finding a biological family of his that were ready prepared to raise for the baby. You know, within a year of that, we had a biological child, then we had another foster child who became available for adoption, our daughter. And then just 2 years after that, we had another bio child. And by that time, it was time to get a bigger house. And it was also important to us to be in a more diverse community. I know it's kind of a word that's used a lot about Marichal, but it was very important to us. Foster children and an adopted child, so, you know, multiracial. Our family, of course, is interreligious, and ethnically, you know, a lot of different kinds of people. And we wanted, you know, all our kids to have the advantage of a community where they get to meet all sorts of people and deal with them and learn what the, you know, what the world is about. So we were in Larchmont 10 years, but when our oldest was 4 was when we came here. Yeah, in 1994 is when we moved to Marichal, not far from Temple Israel.
And you mentioned the fact that you're an interreligious couple. How did that play out with your families when you brought each other to your respective homes?
Yeah, let me say a lot about that. Okay. Fathers were both... my father was very religious, my mother not at all. Somehow she got away with not going to church. Which is interesting because she had a sister who was a nun. My father-in-law was very concerned as well about the cultural aspects and always very concerned if she took my name that people might make anti-Semitic remarks not knowing that she's Jewish. So that, so she suggested and she took up the suggestion or did it on her own. She always called herself Deborah Levy Moore. So there's no doubt about it. Once my family knew Deborah and her family knew me, there's no doubt, in their minds that we'd be okay together and we'd work out whatever we need to about the religious aspects. Now, being the traditionalist I am, although I married somebody Jewish, it was a given then, and maybe less extent now, but, the children would spend more time with the mother, and children need to know they belong somewhere, something. People, at the very, very basically want to know that they're part of a group. So I sort of made the decision, the children should be raised, Jewish, and I shouldn't say I made the decision. I mean, we had discussions in which, one of us thought, maybe a little of each, and one of us, the more traditional one, said, no, you raise a child and let them know they're part of a particular group. And honestly, when we were moving, another big factor moving from Larchmont to Marichal was. At the time, there were local papers, and there would quite often be articles about Rabbi Wall and his interreligious work, his reaching across to the Black community and the Coalition for Mutual Respect, so we knew about the synagogue, and we knew we'd eventually get involved. We know the extent to which we'd get involved at the time. I guess the impetus to really get involved, of course, when you're a child with a lot of people here have a child starting in the Sunday school. Because he wasn't aware, he would talk about those Jews in our neighborhood, you know, because we have a lot of modern Orthodox people dressed in suits walking on Saturday morning, and oh boy, those Jews are having another holiday. You know, so Joe, guess what? so that was when that's when we knew it was time. I think he might have been, you know, it was kindergarten or first grade, but that's the time we started getting involved here.
What was Deborah's religious upbringing as a child?
A Reform synagogue. Her father had been brought up conservative. He went to yeshiva school, I guess, after school every day. Decided to be more in the world, modern, Reform. We had a lot of clients who were members of the synagogue. They were in our Long Island. Deborah's from Long Island.
What town?
Well, Westbury and then Woodbury.
Keeping it with the berries.
Yeah, well, very different kind of. Westbury, at least then, was sort of very diverse community, diverse school. She loved it. But her parents found a bigger place in Westbury, which is more affluent, more homogeneous. And it was when she was in high school, too, so that's a difficult time to switch schools. In fact, the only school reunion I've been to with her was for the one she didn't graduate from. So was she going through junior high school, like I said, then junior high school and through 10th or 11th grade.
And so when you met at party and decided to go out and went on a few dates, when did the issue of religion, or did the issue of religion ever come up, and how was it addressed?
I guess when we got serious, you know, we each realized that, you know, our fathers would have some issues. But I had dated a lot of Jewish girls before. Pretty much that's all the girls I dated before. So I think my parents, you know, were knew what was coming, you know. And then my younger brother also married a Jewish girl from a conservative family who's grandfather was a rabbi. Yeah.
Interesting.
So he had a lot more explaining to do.
So tell us about your experience as a new member of Temple Israel back in the day. What was that like, and what was the experience?
Well, the great thing was, I always just kid Deb about knowing more people than she did here, because I was coaching so many different sports, you know, kids and families. When you're a coach, you're not just the coach for the kid, you're the coach for the whole family. And very warm and accepting. There were always efforts at making people who were not Jewish comfortable here. And I learned a lot. And as I tell Deborah, I can come to services here. There's nothing in those books that I can't say or do as a Christian. Be around, you should come to church, and I discourage you from coming to church. It's really, when I come here, it's more than just accompanying her. I'm a participant, whereas I feel like if she went with me, it'd be, I don't think she'd be as comfortable. And I don't know, honestly, how comfortable I would feel having her see me, worship situation.
Fascinating.
To be honest.
Fascinating. Yeah.
Do you ever drawn all this stuff at me, Paul? You're a regular Sigmund Freud.
Do you ever go to church yourself, just out of habit?
I've been going every Sunday. We have Saturdays and Sundays, but every weekend, just about. As a political figure, especially in the last few weeks. To a lot of the churches.
Other than that, though, do you find that you go to church for religious purposes?
It's what do you say? I mean, the services can be uplifting, can be contemplative. It's good for people just to have some time. You know, I always leave that thing in the car, that phone thingy in the car when I go to a church service, so that I'm not, you know, not reacting to that, and you know, focus at the beginning of the mass or the service on, you know, what's going on in the last week, what I did, what I could have done better, and then the second half, well, what's coming up this week, how can I do things that reflect the values we're trying to learn here. And sometimes I take a nap, but that's, and I have opinions on that too, how long the sermon should be.
Do your kids ever express curiosity about their Catholic family and Catholicism in general?
Not particularly, no.
Not a big fan?
Not really. I mean, you know, we had all the holidays, but they weren't really, especially Christian ones, and weren't really of a religious nature for them. Even Christmas and Easter, you know, for them it was just, you know, family, the extended family gets together, see cousins you don't usually see, aunts and uncles, etc. I think it would have been the same for me at that age, the age that they're old now, in their, you know, late 20s.
What role, if any, does religion play in your children's lives?
At this point, I don't think very much. Well, we finally had one who took the birthright trip, the youngest, Harry, a couple of years ago. I think it educated.
What was his takeaway from that?
More respect for the Jewish community and the way it has persevered through these centuries. I remember having this discussion with Joe when he was about 5 years old. You know, all this stuff, it's just made up, it's just a legend. So, you know, Joe, I mean, these folks have somehow gotten through all these thousands of years of all these bad things that happened, and they're still here, so maybe there's something to defender of the Jews, that's me.
Well, as someone who's had his feet in both ponds, what's your feeling about organized religion in general?
You know, having been not just growing up in one tradition and coming here, but now over the last couple of years visiting all these different houses of worship, it's where the good people are on Sunday, or, you know, or Saturday, as the case may be. You know, just, it gives people a wonderful feeling, and of course the good message. I don't know that it's always easy for folks to remember that once Monday rolls around in their jobs and in their lives. You know, obviously there's been a lot of negative things about things that have happened in various religions and the kind of the tribalism that leads to conflict. I think the tribalism is kind of built into our psyche, whether or not we have religions or not. I suppose to some extent, many of the religions, you know, it's, you know, there's a tribal identity behind it, but, you know, we try to be about more than that.
So, in an attempt to summarize.
Yes, doctor, what do I have?
What traits, characteristics do you think that you inherited from your parents? And what traits and characteristics do you hope to pass on to your kids? What do you want your legacy to be? And what role, if any, has Temple Israel of New Rochelle played in any or all of that?
Number one, of course, is kindness. Deep down, my parents were kind and thoughtful. And certainly that's one I hope I can pass along. Smart, you know, my mother never did any college. My father started, which I only found out after he died. I found like one semester at NYU of all places. You know, it's not one to sit and read a book. But very unless he knew something he was interested in, just to give him something that's in a course. No. So intelligence. Sense of humor, of course, is very important. I think doing that and you know, being around here, how can you help? but learn those things. I think all of those, you know, it was like the three biggies. Kindness, including empathy, and you know, seeing things from other people's side, and trying to reach out to those who are, you know, different from yourself. And from what I can see, my kids, they're doing pretty well so far. I think, you know, not that the parents have anything to do with it, right? And you know, it's just.
Takes a village.
I mean, look, your kids are brilliant.
Right. And, where did that come from? So, any closing thoughts?
You know, Temple Israel is, I think as I said, every time there was a bar mitzvah or a bat mitzvah speech to be given, it's like a second home. I've always felt very comfortable here. And I hope to grow old here, because what's the alternative? Growing old. And, you know, I hope I'm able to, you know, just starting out in this journey, it's like a year and a half being in public service, I'm hoping I get to, now I'm started, I think I'm getting to understand how it works. I think I'm doing a pretty good job at it. I'd like to stick with that a while and make everybody and every institution I'm associated with proud of what I'm doing. Say you knew me when.
Well, Damon Moore, thank you for sharing your memories and your perspectives on life and family and Temple Israel of New Rochelle. And that concludes this interview.
Thank you, Mr. Warhit.